Good morning to everybody. Lovely that you're able to join us for the first in the series on battleships that Rod is going to present. And Rod is such an enthusiast that it's going to be lovely to hear what he's got to say. Let me just introduce Rod. He's a retired financial executive with a corporate career, followed with an entrepreneurial spell with his wife, Coralie, in corporate destination services. They've been living in Amanus for 5 years. Rod trained as a CA in London and came to Southern Africa on a UK government contract in Lesotho in the 70s. And then he got married and never went back to the UK. His interest in naval history in general and battleships in particular goes back to his prep school days in Sussex. We look forward to hearing what you've got to tell us, Rod. Welcome. Thank you.
Thank you, Patricia. I'm going to be talking about battleships and essentially the warships, as to start with, their effect strategically on world power and the use of naval power to influence empires, and how a battle at sea can affect the world empire position. And we go all the way back to the ancient Greeks to start with. The first warship was the trireme. It goes back to the 7th century Corinthians, three banks of oars, approximately 200 man crew, of which 170 were oarsmen. Now, the skill level required to row one of these things, I'm sure, was startling. If any of you have ever tried to row an eight competitively, you will know that quite a lot of it is brawn, but there's a lot of skill and timing involved. The primary weapon of the trireme is the ram. It all forms part of the keel and its principal strength. They did carry some armed soldiers, primarily to repel boarders, because once the triremes are rammed and locked in battle, all the oarsmen have got to jump up and leave their oars, draw their swords, and fight the other crew. The major battle of the ancient world, which some would say almost was pivotal to Western civilization, was in 480 BCE. The Persians had recently defeated the Spartans and the Thespians at the Battle of Thermopylae. That was the famous Battle of the 300. And the city of Athens was surrounded by Persians and the Persian navy. Now, after this battle, the Persian Empire never again threatened European states, and this is how it unfolded.
The Persian fleet put to sea at night, around 600 triremes, outnumbering the Greeks 3-2. Expecting hard fighting at the entrance to the strait, they landed 400 soldiers on the tiny island of Sitalia. Their role was to finish off any shipwrecked Greeks who made it to shore. Then, keeping close to the mainland, the Persian fleet silently advanced into the narrow strait, the elite Phoenicians leading the way. According to a later Greek historian, Diodorus Siculus, the Persians also sent an Egyptian squadron around Salamis to cut off any Greek escape into the Gulf of Megara. But this event is not mentioned in earlier sources, and may be an invention. At dawn, Xerxes arrived at an observation post overlooking the strait. The great king was confident that his presence would inspire his captains to fight with more determination than they'd shown at Artemisium a few weeks before. He was accompanied by scribes, ready to note down the names of captains who fought well, and those who did not. The Persian fleet lined the northern side of the strait, ready to hunt down Greek ships as they fled. What they saw instead was 368 Greek triremes emerging from the bays of Salamis, ready to fight. They formed a line of battle, with the best squadrons on each flank. On the left, the Athenians. On the right, the Aeginetans. As they rowed, they sang paeans, Greek hymns of battle. At first they held formation, perhaps waiting for the morning breeze to blow at their back, or for more Persians to crowd into the strait. Then a Greek ship saw an opening and attacked. Soon both fleets were fully engaged. The battle became a chaotic mass of ships, wheeling, weaving, looking for a chance to ram an enemy and avoid the same fate themselves. In the narrow strait, the Persian squadrons became increasingly disordered. Any ship trying to fall back ran into other ships trying to press forward, their captains eager to impress the great king. What's more, the Persian oarsmen had been rowing all night and soon began to tire. The Greeks were fresh and fighting for their freedom. The Phoenician squadron suffered heavy losses at the hands of the heavy Greek triremes. Some Phoenician captains, who'd abandoned their ships and made it to shore, were brought before Xerxes. They blamed the unfolding disaster on the cowardice of their allies, the Carians and Ionians. Just at that moment, Xerxes saw an Ionian ship ram an Athenian trireme, before it was rammed in turn by an Aeginetan ship. Undaunted, the Ionian marines counterattacked, boarding and taking the Aeginetan ship. After observing this evidence of Ionian bravery, Xerxes ordered that the Phoenician captains be taken away and executed. Wrecked ships, floundering men and corpses clogged the strait, as the battle turned decisively against the Persians. Aeschylus, the playwright, who almost certainly fought in the battle, compared the Greeks killing Persians to fishermen spearing tuna. As Persian ships tried to escape, they were hit in the flank by the Aeginetans, who distinguished themselves above all other Greeks that day. Queen Artemisia was among those trying to escape the slaughter, with an Athenian trireme in hot pursuit. Seeing her path blocked by a friendly ship, she gave the order to ram it. When the Athenian captain saw this, he thought he must be pursuing an allied ship, and went looking for other prey. The remnants of the Persian fleet streamed back to Phaleron. In a final ruthless act of the battle, Aristides landed with a force of hoplites on Sitalia, and massacred the 400 Persians who'd been abandoned there. In total, the Persians lost around 200 ships and 12,000 men, including the fleet commander Ariabignes, a half-brother of the great king himself. The Greeks lost just 40 ships. It proved to be one of the greatest naval victories in history. Our land bewails the men she bore, slaughtered for Xerxes, who has fed hell's hungry jaws with Persian dead. The Greeks had inflicted a humiliating defeat on Xerxes, and ended all hopes of an easy conquest. Now the king heeded Queen Artemisia's advice, and ordered his general Mardonius to continue the campaign in spring, while he returned to Asia with the bulk of his army.
So, they never again threatened European lands. I just want to mention the word thalassocracy. It's not a commonly heard word. It is an empire defined by its sea power. And aside from Greece, the other ancient thalassocracies are Phoenicians and, of course, Carthage, a bit later, who fought the Punic Wars against Rome. Later, Mediterranean thalassocracies were, of course, the Venetians and Portuguese, the Spanish and the Dutch into the Atlantic. Ultimately, the greatest thalassocracy of all was, of course, the British Empire, reliant upon the Royal Navy from the 18th century, the greatest of all thalassocracies. Since 1945, British thalassocracy has been replaced by the US Navy. Now, the Falkland Islands conflict in 1982, however, proved that there is some still some ability by the UK to project power. Thalassocracies need warships and ultimately battleships. To run forward for the next roughly 2,000 years, galleys remain the primary ship of war. They evolved to carry more sails and less manpower. They were used primarily for piracy and raiding in the Mediterranean Sea and around the, as far as the south coast of England, where Barbary pilots caused, to some extent, the depopulation of coastal towns. Such was their effect on the local population. In the 15th and 16th century, the Portuguese navigators, ruled by Henry the Navigator — Henry never actually went to sea, but he did sponsor voyages such as were made around the African coast. Now, the Portuguese caravel was a rather more seaworthy vessel, and it enabled travel in the open Atlantic. They carried 18 sails, which anybody who sailed will know that they traveled to windward much better than a square sail does. In the early 16th century, we see the evolution to galleons. The galleon's an altogether bigger ship, and somebody had a bright idea of putting cannons on them. And that was obviously a game changer. The average galleon mounted up to 40 cannons on two decks, the top deck, and then they'd have a deck in the middle, and they'd have gun ports. That was the first appearance of gun ports. If you look closely at the picture of that Spanish galleon, about half her gun ports are open and the other half are closed. They used to fire a 4-inch round shot of about 8 pounds, and they could fire it about 500 meters, which I think is pretty good for the day. They were square rigged on up to 3 masts, and they were used to bring goods and treasure from the New World in the early 16th century. In the late 16th century, 1588, England and Spain were at war. And King Philip of Spain launched an armada to meet up with the Duke of Parma, who was in Flanders, where they had conquered large parts of France, what is now France and Belgium, to take an army across to conquer England. The following film is from the series A History of Warfare, and it really is a bit of fun.
In the summer of 1588, the affairs of England had reached a desperate juncture. A Spanish invasion fleet, said to be the largest ever assembled, was rumored to be approaching the English coast. Against this mighty armada were ranged the stout-hearted English seamen under Drake, Frobisher, and Hawkins. But at their head was a woman who was to prove she had the spirit to match the most sinister threat in this, her darkest hour. Her name, Elizabeth the First, Good Queen.
The Armada essentially was an escort manoeuvre. It's like the D-Day invasion backwards. The fleet is there to protect the army. Philip appears to have thought that the English wouldn't put up a great deal of resistance. There is not a lot of instruction to Medina Sidonia, the Armada's commander, on how to fight the English fleet. He's told what tactics they will employ, but Philip leaves it very much up to him what to do about them. Similarly, the Duke of Parma is not really told how to conquer England. In some ways that was fair, because Parma was the greatest captain general of his time, and it was up to him to make plans, Philip thought, once he got onto land.
Parma had been instructed to form an army of 30,000 men and make the necessary preparations to transport that force over the Channel under the protection of the Armada. The ships which carried the Spanish Armada in 1588 were very similar in design and construction to those of the English fleet.
There were about 24 frontline warships in the English fleet, and about the same number in the Spanish fleet. And these were the ships that would actually do the bulk of the fighting. The big legend about the Armada is that the Spanish ships were very large and that the English ships were very small. Now that's true in as much as Spanish ships were built high. They had very high castles at the front and back of the ship. This is because the Spanish again were aiming to fight hand to hand. And being up high in a hand-to-hand fight was a big advantage. Because the English weren't going to fight hand-to-hand, they didn't need that advantage. So they built their ships low. They were interested in speed, they were interested in maneuverability, and they were interested in a long ship which could have a lot of guns along its flank.
The English sailors were overawed by the sheer scale of the Spanish fleet. Sailing in a huge crescent formation up the English Channel was some 128 warships and galleys arrayed in a crest formation. Around this huge formation, the English ships exhibited extreme caution.
The first thing that happens in the Armada is that the Spanish approach and the English fleet sails round them. This is very confusing for the Spanish because they obviously are aiming to sail up the channel and they expect the English to try and stop them. But the English have suddenly gone to a lot of trouble to get behind them. What the English are looking to do is close in and use their ship-smashing guns. Now, they have some problem with the Spanish formation because if they try and attack the weakest ships of the Armada, which are inside the Arrowhead, then they are in grave danger of being overwhelmed by the closing wings of the crescent, in which case they would be involved in boarding, and they have no chance if the ships come close together because the English ships don't have troops on them. They cannot fight hand to hand.
English shipboard guns were a good generation ahead of the Spanish ones. They were much easier to handle and consequently a lot faster to reload, and the quality of the gunpowder was better as well. So when it actually came to stand-up fight, although the English ships were in some ways smaller, they could actually throw a far greater weight of metal against the Spanish ones. But again, having said that, although they carried out quite a bit of damage to the Spanish on the way up the channel, they weren't able to cripple the Spanish fleet.
As the two fleets could not come to grips, the fighting was very much reduced to that of a series of skirmishes. Nonetheless, the battleship Rosario was sufficiently damaged that it had to be left behind by the progress of the fleet. Next morning, she was captured by Drake, whose fearsome reputation caused the Spanish to surrender without a fight. The San Salvador was also abandoned and fell prize to Tom Fleming and the Golden Hind. As the Armada proceeded up the channel, Medina Sidonia was aware that his provisions and ammunition were very low. He feared he might now be attacked by what was now obviously a far superior English force, and one which was much better supplied from its home ports. He could get no reply to the various messages he sent to Parma in Flanders, which only added to his unease. As the wind swung round, for once in his favor, he took a decision to seek safety in the port of Calais. It was to prove a disastrous choice.
I just need to say something about Calais. I spent my time in Dover, across the channel as a teenager. Calais is not a big harbour like Durban. It's more like Port Alfred, really. You certainly couldn't get 150 ships in it. So to suggest that they put into Calais is clearly wrong. I'm sure they must have just anchored along the beach. There's a series of beaches run all the way from the west of Calais through to Dunkirk on the east. And I'm sure the Spanish ships were simply anchored some distance off that beach. Another thing we need to know about the channel is that when they talk about the tide, they're not talking about what we talk about here, the tide going up and down. They're talking about the tide flowing. A rising tide in the channel flows strongly from west to east into the North Sea. A falling tide flows back out of the North Sea towards the Atlantic. It's important to note that because a rising tide is what Drake and the boys were after.
To confound the Spanish distress, no extra supplies had been forthcoming in Calais, and many of the Spanish ships were so low on ammunition they could barely resist the English attacks. In many cases, their stocks of gunpowder were completely exhausted, so the great guns could not be fired, leaving the ships defenseless. The English were quick to capitalize on the situation. It was now that Medina realized that the invasion of England could not be attempted. His decision was supported by Palmer on shore, who was concerned by the thorough plans laid for land resistance in England. It was now time for the Spanish fleet to turn for home. But even after Sidonia had taken the decision not to rendezvous with the army of Flanders, bad luck continued to dog his steps. Faced with prevailing winds, which continued to blow against his favored direction of travel, he was left with the only alternative of sailing the fleet completely around the British Isles and home to Spain.
The Armada is running north towards Scotland. They hold a council of war and they decide that when possible they will return to the Channel to renew the fight, but the weather won't let them. They end up north of Scotland and they decide that the only option is to head home, going entirely round the British Isles.
Unfortunately, the problem they had was the chart. If you look at a map of Ireland, it sticks out somewhat into the Atlantic. You've got two great arms. The Spanish maps didn't show the arms or the legs. So when the ships parted and each decided, right, we will rendezvous at Corona, see you there, lads, every ship to make its own speed, and all parted, they all followed the course. Those ships which were well supplied, relatively undamaged and so on, headed well out into the Atlantic, well away from trouble, and managed to get home quite safely. Those ships which had been a bit battered about in the fighting, or which had been running low on supplies because they'd been carrying horses, and horses drink an awful lot of water and so on, decided to keep in by Ireland, not to make such a wide detour, only to discover that Ireland went rather further out into the Atlantic than they thought, which is why there's so many wrecks along the west coast of Ireland.
The English had a very small garrison in Ireland. They were aware that the Armada had at least 16,000 soldiers with it. They were extremely worried that if anything like a large proportion of this landed in Ireland, that there would be a revolt by the native Irish. They react with extreme brutality, and many of the Spanish survivors of the wrecks are murdered out of hand by the English garrison.
Although very few ships were actually lost in battle against the English fleet, dozens of Spanish craft were wrecked in the terrible storms which blighted the unseasonable August of 1588. Ultimately, only 65 ships of the 128 which had set sail from Spain would ever see their homelands again.
The Armada was an extremely important part of English history, both because the invasion was prevented and also because it established the English as the number one naval nation in Europe. They had proved themselves supreme in technology, in sailing ability. They had proved themselves the masters of Atlantic warfare. And Atlantic warfare was where the future lay. Galley warfare in the Mediterranean had gone on for centuries, but its day was over. Drake had proved that he could destroy galleys in Cadiz Harbour. The galleys stood no chance against the sailing ship. Now Drake had proved that the English designed warship was superior to anything that the Spanish or anyone else could put to sea. And that is the foundation of English naval supremacy for the next 300 years.
In the course of researching this, I put a question out to a platform called Quora, which is a question and answer platform. And I asked, why did the Royal Navy rule the waves? And I got a lot of answers. I'll give you some of them. One was so-called race-built hulls. Now, they might not look fast, but they were faster than the other guns. They also sheathed them in copper, which made them faster. That's where the term copper-bottomed comes from. The practice of the Royal Navy to put copper sheets on the hulls of their ships. Their crews received 3 meals a day of reconstituted salt meat, usually pork or beef, and ship's biscuit. And they were served on square wooden plates. That's where square meals comes from. They carried lime juice, which is where limeys comes from. And they mixed their lime juice with grog, their daily grog ration, which was the best quality Navy rum, 55% alcohol from the Caribbean. It was about the equivalent of what we would call today 3 metric tons. There was iron discipline in the Royal Navy. They flogged guys all the time. They had a system since 1707 when the Royal Navy was formed. A little earlier, Samuel Pepys had a lot to do with the organization. The Royal Navy always had a system of promotion based on merit and the ability to take down enemy ships. And their promotion was based thereon, which as we go a little bit further along, we get to Nelson, who was the son of a parson, and certainly no astronaut. The other thing was that their prize system was pretty rigid, and the crews and the captains received all the prize money from capturing enemy ships. That made them pretty keen to do such a thing. Anybody who spent time on the south coast of England, you will see that it's dotted with large houses in sight of the sea. Those are sea captains that made their money from capturing French and Spanish ships. Finally, practice, practice, practice. The Lordships of the Admiralty saw fit to give the Navy plenty of powder with which to practice loading and firing their guns. They didn't practice with cannonballs, they were too expensive. But the average Navy crew could get broadsides off at 2 to 3 times the rate that the French and the Spanish could. As you can understand, their enemies never stood a chance. The galleon warship developed into the ship of the line. This is where we get to a thing that is a proper battleship. It's designed to operate in fleet actions in a line of battle, where they would line up and fire their broadsides at the enemy. And they were developed from this ship here, which is called the Sovereign of the Seas. The Royal Navy had a system of classification of battleships. They called a first rater, carried 100 guns plus on 3 decks. The second rater carried 90 guns on 3 decks, and a third rater, 70 guns plus. Anything much less than that was considered a frigate and would not stand in a line of battle. The majority of Royal Navy battleships were 74-gun third raters, which is what, of course, made HMS Victory such a rarity. I'm showing you a picture now of the HMS Victory's 42-pounder gun deck, which is the lowest of her 3 gun decks. The gunpowder is kept in magazines on even lower decks. If you look there on the extreme right of the picture, you'll see some stairs, which is down which the powder monkeys, the small boys, 10 to 14 years, run up and down those stairs carrying bags of black powder up to the guns. These big guns had a crew of as many as 16 men to man a 42-pounder gun. And they had the smaller guns on the upper deck. I want to just run through the steps required to load and fire one of these things. They're called truck guns rather than field guns. This small wooden truck the gun is carried on with 4 small wooden wheels allows it just to be rolled backwards and forwards on this, the gun deck. Obviously, this gun deck is a very well built and supported deck. You know, these are very heavy items. they lay the gun, it's called laying it in naval terms rather than aiming it, they lay it by use of a wedge at the back here. And the more you knock the wedge in, it will bring the muzzle of the gun down. Basically, the experience of the gun captain will decide how far he must bang in the wedge. So, first thing to do is to roll the gun amidships. Now, by that I mean rolling back towards the middle of the ship. So back over here. They then search the barrel with this item in the middle here. You can see these three unloading items hanging up above the gun here. The one in the middle you can't see very well, but it's a thing a bit like a drain cleaner. And they go in and they pull out any old bits of bags of powder that may still be in the gun. They then swab the barrel with a wet sponge. There's the wet sponge. You see the thing at the top here, and the barrel for water, the water barrel there. They dipped in the water barrel and ran it down the barrel to cool the barrel off so that the powder didn't go off prematurely. They then throw in the charge, might be 1, 2, 3 bags of powder, and ram it to the back of the barrel using the ram, which is that third thing you see at the top there, is a ram, which they push it hard to the back there. They then roll the ball in and ram that down, and they put some rope wadding in to stop it rolling out. They may not bother with that in the heat of battle, but if you are sailing around with your gun loaded, obviously you've got cannonball to roll out with the roll of the ship. They then prick and prime with a squib. It's called a squib, which is a piece of thick straw which is sharpened at the end, and they knock that in to make a hole in the charge, one of the bags of black powder. It is then fired with what is called a gun lock, and the gun captain will fire it, but he will be sure that there's nobody standing behind the gun, and he will stand with a lanyard at the side of the gun to fire it. A well-trained crew, a well-trained Royal Navy crew, could get 3 shots off in a 5-minute cycle. French tended to only manage 1 or maybe 1.5. HMS Victory, I wanted to spend the last of this lecture talking in some detail about HMS Victory. There she is in dry dock in Portsmouth Harbour, some 200 and whatever it is years after the Battle of Trafalgar.
HMS Victory is, of course, a first-rate ship of the line, one of the Royal Navy's flagships, and the oldest commissioned warship in the world. Back in the 18th century, the first-rate ship of the line was the single most technologically advanced item that could be produced by mankind, and it could move as well. However, they were not common. The bulk of the battle fleets of major navies were made up of third rates and fourth rates, although the latter were gradually disappearing in the larger navies. A few second rates were also around, but first rates were rare, occupying the same kind of niche as the supercarrier does today. They were big, expensive to build, and expensive to run, with even the mighty Royal Navy not able to afford to maintain many of them, despite the advantage that such ships had given them in previous wars, such as the Anglo-Dutch Wars of a century before. During times of peace, they were often placed in deep reserve, only brought back into service when needed. Luckily, the advance of naval technology was of a speed such that a ship could spend a decade or two in reserve and then, with relatively minimal work, go right back to being a frontline combat unit, providing that care and attention was paid during the ship's time in ordinary, which was the term they used for reserve service back then. This tended to mean that first-rate ships could last for decades and thus needed replacement relatively infrequently. At least in the hands of the Royal Navy, which, occasional annoying Dutchmen aside, was generally pretty good at keeping its hand on its first rates, supplemented occasionally by helpful donations in action from foreign navies, usually the French. The name HMS Victory had a varied history in the mid-1750s. The Anglo-Dutch War era had had a second rate of that name launched in 1620, which lasted 70 years before being broken up. And then a first rate of 100 guns, the HMS Royal James, had taken up the name in 1691 to maintain continuity, the ship itself lasting from build a total of 46 years before being accidentally burnt in 1721, the fate of a worryingly large number of major capital ships over the centuries in the Age of Sail. 16 years later, a new first-rate Victory had been launched, but after commissioning as what would turn out to be the last British capital ship armed entirely with the more expensive bronze cannon, as opposed to the developing mass-produced iron guns, she only lasted 4 years before being wrecked in a storm and lost with all hands on her way back from a successful naval operation in 1744. Now, 14 years after that disaster, William Pitt the Elder, then Prime Minister, placed an order for the building of 12 ships, including a single first-rate ship. The rarity of first rates can be illustrated that, despite the fact that Britain was involved in numerous major wars in the 18th century, this order was one of only 10 first-rate ships that were to be constructed during that entire 100-year period, and one of those had been the previous Victory. As with most ships of the period, she was supposed to be an iterative design, with first drafts based on HMS Royal George, another first-rate that had recently been launched. The job of turning this into a detailed design for the new ship was providentially given to the master naval architect Sir Thomas Slade, who was also surveyor of the Navy. As a first-rate, she was to carry at least 100 guns and would be built in the Chatham Dockyard. The keel was laid on the 23rd of July 1759, and her name, Victory, was finally chosen in October 1760. It's possible, although not entirely possible to confirm, that the name was chosen as much to commemorate 1759, the so-called Annus Mirabilis, or Year of Miracles, in the Seven Years' War, as it was to continue the line of ships named Victory in the Royal Navy, as there were a little bit of discontent over reusing the name after such a major disaster as the previous ship had been. There is also a more prosaic reason. Out of just over half a dozen names the Admiralty had come up with that were suitable for one of the Royal Navy's major combat units, it turned out they'd already made ships named after all but one of them, and Victory was the only one that wouldn't require bringing in another ship and renaming that one as well. This was where a series of very fortunate events began to chain together. Firstly, Sir Thomas Slade was a naval architectural genius who was not content to merely iterate, but in fact make a number of small innovations and improvements on the design that he'd been tasked with. Next, the Seven Years' War ended, so whilst it was common practice to build the ship's frame and then leave the wood to season over, say, spring and summer, the sudden slowdown in construction meant that Victory would stay covered and seasoning for almost 3 years, which would massively increase the endurance of her basic structure. She was finally ready to go in May 1765 at a total cost of £63,176.03. Now that might not seem like much today, and indeed a simple inflation calculator would suggest that this is equivalent to £8 to £11 million in today's money. But in terms of actual economic cost to the country, a truer estimate of the impact on national finances, or what you might deem purchasing power, would be something in the order of just over £1 billion. Now, this isn't to say that the launch, or more accurately, the floating out of dry dock, went without issue. As the ship was so large, the dock gates were not quite wide enough to let it through, which led to a frantic night's work with Edzes paring back the gates.
Talk a little bit first about the Battle of Trafalgar. The French and the Spanish had been holed up in Cadiz for some months, as we will see from the film that you're about to see concerning HMS Victory. Admiral Villeneuve had heard on the grapevine that he was about to be replaced by Napoleon, so he thought maybe it'd be a good idea to get the fleet around to the Mediterranean. So he sailed out of Cadiz. He then got wind that Nelson was close by and he panicked. And he about turned his fleet to head back towards Cadiz, which is why you can see the French and the Spanish, which are the blue and the black ships, are heading north, which is at the top of your screen. The French and the Spanish amounted to 33 line of battle ships, including the largest ship in the world, which is just there, close to Nelson's ships, the Santa Sima Trinidad, you can read that. The Spanish ship carried 130 guns, the largest ship in the world at the time. Nelson had 27 battleships and two columns. Villeneuve had 30,000 men and nearly 2,600 guns against Nelson's 17,000 sailors and 2,150 guns. It was a 22 mil victory, which is pretty conclusive. You can see from this picture the two columns of Nelson's sailing into the French and Spanish ships. Drakeniethal will take up the story. He starts in 1803 when Nelson is on HMS Victory to join the fleet to be its commanding officer. There's a picture here which shows Nelson saying farewell to Lady Hamilton, who, as we know, had his love child. He will never see her again, so he said.
In May 1803, the restored ship was ready to go and received the now Vice Admiral Nelson and promptly headed out to sea to meet up with Admiral Cornwallis. Partway along, Nelson would transfer to the frigate HMS Amphion to better find the rest of the fleet that he was to lead, with Victory contenting itself with running down and capturing a French frigate, the 32-gun Ambuscade, which had been a British ship, then captured by the French, and now back in British hands, with Victory using her remarkable turn of speed again to run down an unsuspecting enemy vessel. The next year and a bit was something of a wild goose chase, with the Franco-Spanish combined fleet being thought to first be heading for Egypt, then actually having turned out to have made off for the Caribbean in an effort to draw off the main British fleet so that Napoleon could launch a cross-channel invasion, which was unfortunately not named La Lion de Mer. However, heading back to Europe, the Franco-Spanish fleet had run into another British fleet under Sir Robert Calder, and whilst the Battle of Cape Finisterre was indecisive, thanks in part to fog, and in part to Calder not being as willing to engage against the odds as Jervis had been, it did serve to deflect the enemy fleet from their course, such that they would eventually wind up at Cadiz rather than on the Channel coast, with a special shout-out in that battle to HMS Malta for taking on five enemy capital ships at once, and forcing two of them to surrender. The Victory would, after a brief diversion to England, rejoin and strengthen the British forces off Cadiz, with a total of 27 ships of the line to face off against 33 French and Spanish vessels. The subsequent Battle of Trafalgar will get its own detailed video at some point in the future, so we won't go into it in extreme detail here, but Victory once again showed her speed, leading one of two British columns into the heart of the enemy formation and taking fire from half a dozen enemy capital ships, including Santissima Trinidad, on the way in. One enterprising man aboard decided that a small keg of 500 musket balls made an excellent addition to the 68-pounder carronade's heavy shot when the call came for double and then treble shotting, and thus carrying the world's biggest shotgun and flying the famous signals "England expects every man will do his duty," followed by "engage the enemy more closely," the Victory broke through the line between the French flagship, the 80-gun third-rate Bucentaur, and the 74-gun third-rate Redoutable. At a range so close that the flames of the guns were singeing the windows of the French flagship before the shockwave and cannonballs arrived, the Victory's port guns unleashed a devastating rolling broadside, raking the French flagship from the stern, blowing a hole in it described as large enough to drive a coach and four horses through. This dismounted guns and shredded the crew in a maelstrom of cannonballs, grape shot, and the 500 musket balls from the carronade, killing or wounding somewhere between 300 and 450 men of the ship's 750 to 800 man complement in a matter of seconds. Exact numbers of casualties and crew total depends on which report you believe. At a stroke, however, the French flagship was rendered out of action and mostly an afterthought to be used for target practice by subsequent British vessels. Victory then fell in alongside Redoutable, whose captain had enterprisingly trained his crew in sharpshooting and close action in the absence of anything better to do while stuck in Cadiz, and would thus spend most of the rest of the battle alternately blasting away at the French ship and putting out the fires that her guns had started lest they spread back onto the Victory. With the French concentrating on clearing the main deck of the Victory with small arms fire, Nelson was fatally wounded by a sharpshooter in Redoutable's masts and carried below, the French ship eventually giving up the fight when HMS Temeraire wandered past and blasted most of the gathering French boarding party clean off the deck. having effectively tanked a good portion of the enemy fleet on the way in and been exposed to further fire from enemy ships whilst locked in with Redoutable, Victory was badly damaged and was not able to move under her own sail, as they were rather more an interesting collection of holes held together with a bit of canvas than anything else. HMS Neptune would therefore tow her to Gibraltar for repairs before she would carry Nelson's preserved body back to England for a state funeral.
After Trafalgar, Victory was indeed repaired, but she was never again the iconic warship she had been. In 1822, she was relegated to act as a guardship in Portsmouth and the flagship of the Port Admiral. That is a job she has held ever since, pretty much. The Navy at some point wanted to break her up and make use of the wood. Bear in mind, Victory was built in the 1760s, and it took 6,000 trees, most of which were 200-year-old oak trees. It's often said it takes 200 years to build one of these things. Yes, first you've got to grow your oak trees. It was made of a lot of very valuable wood. However, the British public simply would not allow the Navy to break her up. And they mounted several Save the Victory campaigns. They opened to the visitors. And that is the way it's been ever since Victorian times. And she's been preserved as a commissioned warship and has retained her HMS designation. They restored her to 1805 condition in time for the 2005 Trafalgar 200 years Royal Navy celebration. So she is now still in the condition she was in the days of the Battle of Trafalgar. Unfortunately, if you look at it closely, you will see that there are actually the masts are in sort of double sections. There's a lower mast and a top mast. The top masts have had to be removed because of the stress the rigging was putting on the keel. I believe they are strengthening the keel and hope to get the top masts back on again. If you go and see her now, though, she's looking like that, I'm afraid, which is not as she should be. You'll see that the top masts are missing. In 2012, she was handed over to the National Museum of the Royal Navy. And although still formally a commissioned warship, you can now take pictures on board, something that was previously forbidden. Thank you very much, everybody.
Right, any questions from anybody? I've visited HMS Victory and had spent quite a while on it.
It's not really a question about Victory, but when I visited Victory probably about 10 years ago, there was another ship also preserved, and it was plated in iron. It was a wooden hull ship plated in iron. It had muzzle-loading guns on the deck, but in the prow it had a huge breech-loading gun. And it was also a semi-steamer that steamed and sailed. And it had two huge reciprocating piston engines. I can't remember the name of it.
Warrior, HMS Warrior, good work. She was the first Royal Navy ironclad. And she carried 62 or 68 pounder guns.
That was a huge gun.
Even bigger than Victory's. She was, yes, she carried quite a good sail plan as well as her steam engines. Yes, she was very much the transition between what we now see as wooden battleships, and we end up next week we'll talk about dreadnoughts. So between wooden battleships and dreadnoughts.
Rod, I seem to remember from your previous presentation that it was not possible with a large number of guns like a Victory to fire all the guns simultaneously. They had to be fired in their sequence, otherwise they would capsize the ship on which they were. Is that correct? And what was the sequence in which they were fired?
Didn't fire them all at once. You saw in Draken Neefel's film the picture of the Victory passing through between Redoutable and Bosentaire. She's actually firing both broadsides, port and starboard. That is comparatively rare too. Essentially, gun crews, you look at the deck of the Victory, you look at the deck of the Victory there, there was 200 men sleeping on that deck. They were sleeping in hammocks slung from the ceiling, and they would generally man one broadside, and if they needed to, they'd go across and man the other broadside. In the case of Trafalgar, when they passed through the French line, they had to fire both at once. But they fired as the gun bared. It was up to the gun captain to sight down the barrel and see when he had a target, and he would fire his gun. So they would, yes, they'd go boom, 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 down the gun deck. He called it a rolling broadside, normal thing they would do.
Thank you, Rod. That was fascinating. And we look forward to the rest of the series. Thank you very, very much.